Hello everyone and thanks for coming. I'm Tomasa Rodrigo from BBVA Research and I'm going to present together with Álvaro our work to quantify social and geopolitical events using big data. Okay, we have structured our presentation in three parts. First of all, I'm going to briefly describe what we are going to do, what we do, why and how we do it. And then Álvaro is going to show you some applications in the geopolitical arena. And finally, I'm going to conclude showing you another application in the digital field. Okay. Well, why is important for us the use of big data? We live in a world that is continuously changing with a lot of events happening in real time. Using the traditional data, we don't have the way in most of the cases, to measure these events, to knowing and to quantifying their impact in order to know how important they are. In order to solve it, we use big data and we use information from the media in order to quantify all these events. Example of these events are, for example, geopolitical events. The Arab Spring, it increased instability in the Middle East and North Africa to levels that are not come to previous levels and are really important. Also, we have political events, like for example, elections, okay? Independence wars, for example, like the Brexit or the Catalonian current situation, and also the rise of populisms. And with this database, we are going to quantify all these trends. We also, until now, we also don't have any way of measuring a natural disaster, like an earthquake, or to measure epidemics, like it was the case of Ebola. Then the use of big data and data science techniques allow us to cover this gap and to measure these trends that until now, we don't have any quantitative information. We only have qualitative information about them. It has supposed a milestone in this research area, since now we know what is happening in the world in real time, and we can complement our traditional data using this source of information in order to understand better what is happening in the society. Okay, this is possible now thanks to the development of a faster and better infrastructure that allow us to work with really granular data, combining historical information with real-time data. Also, combining this with the development of new algorithms, tools, and techniques, what we have is a better understanding of the world just in real time. But for sure, it's also important to have the competencies to take advantage of all of this new world in the digital area. Here, I would like to mention that it's really important to make the right questions to our data. Okay? I think probably this is obvious, right? But I think that it's important to highlight because we have a lot of a lot of unstructured data, so you need to know from the beginning what you want to get from this data and what question you want to solve, because if not, it's probably that you are going to get lost and the data could give you some message in different directions. So the labor here and the role of the analyst is really, really essential in order to have a successful project. And of course, you need to know how to manage with these large databases and also to have the econometrical and statistical skills in order to manage and to analyze these results and to interpret them. All in all, I want to highlight that this new world with this new data is changing the society, and also it changes the way in which economies are working to solve the empirical questions, okay, in order to take advantage of all this new world in the digital area. Now I'm going to briefly describe our working process in BBVA Research. For this project, we are going to use a database that collects information from the media. I'm going to explain to you later, and it is called GDELT. For exploiting this database, we are going to use Google BigQuery that allows the user to interact with the data and also to process petabytes of data in just seconds. Okay, it's really, really fast and has a really high flexibility. Then the important part for our side in BBVA Research is the analysis part, to clean this data, to transform the data, and to apply the most appropriate analysis in each case. And this is where we add value in our work, in order to articulate all this data to have to enrich all our analysis and also to tackle these new concerns that are in the new digital area. And for sure, it is also really important to show the results in a really simple and clear way. So you will see, we hope to cover this part. Okay, now let's go to the database. GDEL database is a database that collects, is an open source database that collects information from the media, in the web, print and broadcast, okay, from the regional level, local level, national level, and also the international level. This database comes from 1979 to today, and it is updated almost in real time. It is updated every 15 minutes and collects information for 65 different languages, okay? All these articles are translated into English in real time, and a vast list of different algorithms are processed with this data in order to know and to identify more than 100 of events that goes from a protest to a peace appeal. Also, it identifies thousands of emotions from the anxiety to the happiness. It identifies more themes that are taxonomies in the database that could go from trade to cyber attacks. And also it includes information about locations, people, and organizations, giving us a monitor in real time of the world that help us to understand what is happening, why is happening, where is happening, and how this could translate to other geographies. Also in GDEL, you can find different measures of sentiment analysis. Okay, the most common one is just to take into account in each article that it is speaking about a particular topic, all the words that has a positive connotation, then the words that has negative connotation, and then to have the balance of them. For doing this, the GDEL applies more than 40 different dictionaries according to each article. But moreover, if we want more granular information, we can do it using the global content analysis measures that give you the intensity and score value depending on the emotions that appears inside the article. Well, once we know the database we are going to work and you know more or less some insights about our working process, we are going to show you a battery of our products inside BBVA in order to cover all the geopolitical and social events that are happening every day. And now Álvaro is going to show you.
Thank you very much, Tomasa. So 4 or 5 years ago, we realized that we were living two important trends. The first is the digital revolution, the big data revolution, and the second thing, what was happening in the world, is that the world is changing very, very fast. So it was a common point to mix all of this, what we do, big data, to analyze how the world is feeling. So let me share with you some of the tools that we developed to try to analyze what is happening in the world. First, we can track how is the geopolitical feeling of the world on real time. If you go check these slides, we can check in real time what happened in the world from 1980 to now, and you can see there are some hot spots. If you can go to the right, we can zoom in what is happening in a fixed place of the world, and everybody knows what is happening more or less in the Middle East. So we can start to see how these the problems are spreading and which are the key hotspots in every region. Si vamos a la siguiente, we can track also what's happening in the world, the feeling of the world in terms of conflict in a time series. For example, in the graph on the left, what we observe is from the 1980s, how the conflict of the world has been evolving. And there is a midline, which is the dotted line. So what are we living now? What are we observing now in the world is that we are above average. So there are a little bit more problems than the average. But this problem we're living before in the 80s. What is happening is that during the 90s and the beginning of the 2000s, we were living in a relatively peaceful at times. We can analyze the same in terms of countries. And we can focus only not only in conflict in general, but how the world is protesting. You know that in the TV, in the media, and the newspapers, we can hear a lot about social unrest. So you can see in this color map two areas of the world, the developed countries, the ex-communist countries, and the Middle East, by colors, by dark blue, light blue, and red. You can see, and the graph is in the color map, is from the 1980s, the beginning. You see that we, the Western countries, we more or less live in a peaceful, we protest, we don't protest too much. More recently, we have been protesting too much, but not like the 80s, what, for example, Mrs. Thatcher, or there are a lot of terrorist groups, including in Spain, but also in the UK and in Italy, at the beginning of the 80s. A different situation was, for example, what was happening in the ex-communist country. As you see, light blue means peaceful moments, dark blue means tension moments. What you see is that these countries, at the beginning of the when the Berlin Wall fall, were living moments of stress, then perhaps relapse somehow, and then there are some hot spots that should be monitored because something could happen. A more interesting case is what happened in the Middle East. Middle East, although this is a conflict zone, there are not too many people protesting because of several reasons. So what you can see is a relatively light blue, like peaceful moments until something happens, and it happens in 2011, when the beginning of the Arab Spring. And what the map shows is what happened, how sudden was, and how was spreading in the rest of the country. By the way, one of the things that we are monitoring now is that this situation is unsolved in some of the countries. So it continues in dark blue. If we go to the following slide, we can analyze also the current hot spots. You can see, for example, in the left, this is an interesting map. It is in red the origin of migration flows, and in orange the destiny of the migrants. And this is happening not very far from here. It's happening in Africa. They are flying out from Africa, from Syria, and from Iraq, but the destiny is Europe. And it is not especially particularly Spain. It's the heart of Europe. It is Germany, and France, and Denmark. And this has social consequences in our societies. We can also track another type of issues which are very far from Europe but could also influence what is happening here. And this is, for example, what is happening with North Korea. You can see a gray band in the middle, which is the average tension in the world, and how rapid the tension erupted in North Korea. But big data allows one thing, and this is we can observe the things in high definition, in 4K, like the TV. So we are not talking, as an economist, we used to talk about countries. But now we can talk about countries, we can talk about counties, in the case of the states, or provinces, but we can really go down to the heart. That is like the cities, individuals, and the streets. And we can check what is happening, for example, in some of the cities that everybody knows what happened. Like the protests that happened in Cairo, and you can see this is the map of Cairo, but this is at the street level where the things were really happening. And we can check this every 15 minutes, so the amount of information is very important. We can show what happened in Istanbul 5 years ago, or what happened also in Hong Kong. Finally, the big data help us to understand how the things are interrelated. This is, for example, a network analysis, what we did for the North Korean crisis. You are, most of you developers and specialists in big data, and you can check that at the heart of the network, it is the leader, it is politics in general, it is conflict and safety and crisis. But if you go, for example, to downward in the map, you will see things that are related to digital government, to cybercrime. And this is how intensive, for example, the government of North Korea and Russia and all of the neighbors are using this cyber war in this conflict. On the right, what you can see is the sentiment, as Thomas showed you, about all of the topics, how they are darkening. So how the situation about not only about democracy, but also if you go to the bottom of the about terror, killing, and some serious of things like armed conflict are getting darker. So that means that something is really happening. You can also move and to understand everybody. Somebody says that China could suffer in a slowdown, and the question is how the people of the different countries of the world feel about it. And this is the map. Of course, you will see very dark colors, in this case orange, in China, of course, because it's at the origin of the problem, in the neighbors, in the trade partners. You can also, it is very interesting to see what's happening in Africa, because some of the African countries are supporting raw materials to China, so they are really worried about, and especially in some of the Latin American countries. You can also check these networks on the, how the groups of the countries, how there are different preoccupations about the issue. We can also check that in a really nice way what happened with the world trade. You really heard about in the newspapers that the world trade is declining, is in a slump, and we analyze two things. What happened with trade in terms of material cooperation, so physically how the countries sign agreements and bilateral agreements on trade, and how is the verbal cooperation with it is different. So some politicians can say that they are very open to trade, but at the same time signing restrictions to trade. And what we see on the left is the, talking about material cooperation, the real truth is that the mood on trade was really declining from the beginning of the 2000s. But it was only when the financial crisis erupted, when this sudden stop in the media, in the politicians, and it's now at the very low levels. Who are the suspects to talk against that, the trade? Here we have the map, and in dark colors you can see who are the more restrictive countries in terms of verbally. And here are the big players. The reality is that the big players, China and the US and Russia. And finally, we can analyze different types of things. Tomasa talked to you about emotions, and we can understand or try to understand how the world feels towards anything, towards something. And this is, for example, how is the Spanish perception around the world? What the rest of the world thinks about the Spaniards? And you can see in positive tone in greens, neutral, or in negatives, and how this is evolving. In general terms, people really likes or feels that the Spanish are good people because the green colors predominate. And we hope to this to continue. So I finish here. I will translate to Tomasa to continue to explain some another interesting trends.
Yeah, just finally to conclude with our presentation, we are going to show you some of the digital trends. Okay, you know that, for example, in the bank, we are in a digital transformation area. We want to be digital, we want to advance here, and we want to know how the world sentiment in each geography is speaking about it. You know that here is information from the media, but you can know how the society, how the streets speaks about digital sentiments in each of these geographies. Doing this map, that we have it in daily basis, what you can see for the aggregate period of 2017 is that there are differences between regions. For example, the Asia regions, together with the United States, has predominantly positive tone speaking about digital. Instead, for example, the Middle East and North Africa, the tone is more negative, which makes sense. Apart from have this cross-country comparison and this granular information, we also have an index that captures the evolution over time. I want to highlight here that this index collects more than 50 different variables relating with digital. And all these variables can be aggregated in three different components: the variables that are related with the digital economy, the ones that are related with fintech, and the ones that are related with the digital regulations. Taking into account all this information, this huge amount of information, we use a principal component analysis in order to aggregate and to have a comprehensive view about how they are evolving. So here you can see for the main players, the US, emerging Asia, and Europe, how these trends are evolving over time, and which are the most important topics in which we need to focus our attention, because could be like a weakness or not. Now, focusing on a particular case of this digital world, we also monitor the evolution of big data according to the media. For example, in these timelines, you can see the evolution of the media coverage of big data. So you see that there are more articles speaking about big data in the world, because it's increasing. And now in the other graph, you can see the sentiment, the perception of this topic according to each country. So you see that the best perception about digital topics, big data topics, are in the US and also in some of the emerging Asian countries like India, Indonesia, Malaysia. And in the bottom line, we have Pakistan, for example. And finally, what we are going to show you, this is a preliminary work that we have started now, is to see how all these variables, these more than 50 variables that we have covered for different topics speaking about digital, how this could have an impact, could affect innovation and productivity, as well as development in the job market. Okay, we know that digital is really important, but it is translated to the world, to the employment, and to productivity. For doing it, we apply different methodologies, like BMA, and here what I'm showing to you is the cross-countries comparison. So you can find, in a comprehensive view, all the countries and how they are focusing, what digital variables affects more for explaining change in the job market and also in the productivity and innovation. And you see that the countries with digital variables are having a higher effect on this productivity and job development are the US, countries in the developed Europe, and also countries in the emerging Asia, that are countries that are growing a lot, that are really fast in incorporating digital technologies, and it is having an impact on the job development, like it is the case of India, Indonesia, Philippines, for example. And with this, we have finished with the battery of products that we want to show you. And here you can find us. And if you have any question, anything that you want to discuss, we are more than pleased in solving your questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The second one, which is also linked, is: do you see governments or public organizations using big data more than the traditional indicators like the democracy index and indicators like such?
Yeah, of course, we are in a new area and we are a data-driven company, so we want to use the data in order to improve our insights, and also it's really important to complement the information that we have until now. Okay, the previous information, or previous methodologies, of course, we are going to continue to using it. But now we have the opportunity to exploit the potential of the data in order to enrich this traditional analysis. And for example, we in the bank are using a lot different methodologies, different sources of information, like in this case, is information from the media, in order to have a more comprehensive view of what is happening in the society. Moreover, because in that case, there are a lot of events that we don't have any information about them, just qualitative information that we can manage. That, for example, I see that instability could start to increase in the North Africa or Middle East, but until now we don't know how to quantify it. What is the impact? What is the impact to translate it to the economy? Now, with these new methods, we can do it, and we can see what are these impacts. So for sure, we are using it. And answering your second question, of course, that there are more international organizations, governments, the Department of Defense, for example, that are using this type of data. For example, in this particular case, in the case of GDELT, we saw that different organizations like the Department of Defense in the US are using this data that comes from the street, from the society, to measure perceptions, to measure how topics are covering more ground. And also the World Bank is working with it. So I think that here we have a huge field for exploring, and we need to take it into account and to use it to improve our knowledge about the society, our clients, and everything.
Thank you.
Hi. Most of the analysis you have shown us is descriptive. Do you have any intention of starting any predictive analysis with all this data?
We yeah. not only have the intention that we already started. It is yeah. not here because the topic of it was geopolitics. Geopolitics is something which is difficult to forecast because it's such a two shocks that things can be evolving. But for example, we have used some of these indexes which are in the media to improve our forecasting models. And here, the real advantage is not specifically forecasting, but now casting. And it is the ability for us to know what is happening on real time. And this is very important because most of our indicators that we use have a delay in their publication. For example, in some countries, an unemployment rate has published with 2 months lags or whatever. So for us, and for the policymakers, and for the central banks, I want to complement to the other question that one of the international organizations which are relying more increasingly in the big data are the central bank, the international organization dedicated to forecasting, like the IMF. So with that, we understand, and for example, in time of stress, in time of crisis, this will be very, very useful for the authorities because they will feel about what is happening really in real time. And this gives you the advantage to react also in real time and not what the thing has deteriorated so much.
Yeah. Also, just to add one comment, we also published some working papers where we were deepening in this analysis. For example, we studied how is the social contagion in the Middle East area, taking into account all these social trends where we can measure a protest, since it is like a really soft demonstration on the street, to a violent protest, and how this society could evolve to a conflict, and what is the response of the government to this. Okay? And we studied this for different type of countries. And one interesting result that we got is that countries with more economic resources have more power to influence in the society in order to calm the situation. Okay, so and also countries with less resources, is more frequently that a protest goes to a conflict than in the other case around. So we have more deep analysis on it. And also another example that Alvaro saw used about the China slowdown, the country network, this is not just the figure with the network. We have here the structure in order to identify when we have a shock, like this slowdown, how it could translate to another countries and which is the mechanisms in order to identify the most affected countries for this shock. So this information also gives us some insights in order to quantify these trends, to enrich our models, and to know how they are going to evolve.
Okay, thank you.
Any other question? Okay, so thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.